Hello everyone, my name is Dominic Baloyi. I'm back again so that we can do more examples on how to calculate beams. We will be doing applied level 4, topic 2. So on today's beam that I've drawn on the board, it's a beam that includes the uniformly distributed load. So uniformly distributed load, it is a load that gets distributed for every meter. You've got 20 newtons that is being applied on the beam for every meter. So our UDL runs for 6 meters from the total 10.5 meters of our beam. So the first thing that we do on this kind of a beam is that we're going to start by making our UDL a point load. What do I mean by a point load? A point load is similar to 90, 70, 80, and 90 because they are acting on a specific point on our beams. So how we're going to make our UDL a point load is that for every 20 newtons per meter, we've got a distance of 6 meters, meaning that meter cancels meter, and then we've got 20 times 6, of which is 120 newtons. This becomes our point load for our UDL. But this particular point load, 120, where is it going to act? It's going to act at the center of our UDL. We're going to have 120 newtons. So now the distance is going to be 3 meters on this side, 3 meters on this side, because it's acting at the center of our distance, of which is 6 meters of the UDL. After we have now made our UDL a point load, it means that we can now calculate reactions F and G. So in us calculating F and G, we're going to use the same procedures or methods that we have used on the previous example to calculate the reactions. We're going to start by making F our fulcrum point, meaning that we're going to take moments at F. When we take moments at F, we check which forces are going clockwise and which forces are going anti-clockwise. So our formula is going to proceed to say the sum of clockwise moments is equal to the sum of anti-clockwise moments. So from this beam, we can see that from the fulcrum F, we've got forces of 70, we've got another force of 120, 80, and 90. All these forces, they are going in the clockwise direction from our fulcrum point. 120 is going in the clockwise direction, 80 is going in the clockwise direction, so is 90. So any other force, we've got our reaction G. Our reaction G, where is it going? It is pushing against all the forces that are being applied on the beam, meaning that it is pushing upwards, meaning that it's going to rotate in the anti-clockwise direction upon our fulcrum F. So we're now going to write our calculation in this way to say that we've got 70 times the distance from the fulcrum to the force. Our distance, it is not written, but from what it is given on our beam, we can actually calculate and find out what is the distance that is not given. The total distance of our beam, it is 10.5. Or rather, we can say between the two reactions, we've got 8 meters, but for the UDL, we've got 6 meters, meaning that the remainder of the distance is 2 meters. So therefore, we're going to have 70 times distance 2, Plus, we've got 120, our point load. The distance from the Falcon point F to that distance, it's 5. Plus, we've got 80. The distance from the fulcrum to 80, it's 8. Plus, we've got another force, 90. The distance from the fulcrum to 90, it is 10.5. Equals to anti-clockwise moments, we only have G that is going anti-clockwise. We're going to have G times the distance from the fulcrum to G, it is 8. From there, we can do our calculations to find out what is the value of our reaction G. We're going to have 8G is equals to 70 times 2, of which is 140. Then we've got 120 times 5, it's 600. We've got 80 times 8, it's 640. We've got 90 times 10.5, of which it gives us 945. From there, we add these values together. We're going to have 945 plus 640 plus 600 plus 140. They give us 2,325, being equals to 8G. We then divide all sides by 8, and then we're going to get our value, of which is 290.625 Newton meters. That is our value G. Then we can write G here to be equals to 290.625. From there, we now move and make G our fulcrum point. We're going to make G our fulcrum point. In doing so, it means that we are now going to calculate reaction F. So when we make G our fulcrum point, then we go back to our forces to check which forces are going to go in the clockwise direction and which forces are going to go in the anti-clockwise direction. When we make G our fulcrum point, we can see that we've got force 90. When it applies pressure this way, it means it's going clockwise. Then we've got our force 120. It is going in this direction. It is anti-clockwise. 70 as well, it's going in that direction. It's anti-clockwise. 90 as well, it's going in that direction. It's anti-clockwise. But a lot of students will then ask that, but what about this 80? This 80, we don't include it because it's on the same axis with our fulcrum point, of which the distance will be equals to zero. So we don't include that 80. From there, we will go on and calculate moments at G. Moments at G. We're going to say the sum of clockwise is equals to the sum of anti-clockwise moments. Then we can deduce from our beam that for clockwise, we've got 90 times the distance from fulcrum point G to 90, it's 2.5. Another force that is going clockwise, if we look at F is our reaction. It's applying force in the upward direction. Where is it rotating our beam? F is pushing our beam in that direction, meaning that it's also going in the clockwise direction. So we're going to say F times the distance to fulcrum G, it's 8, being equals to. Anti-clockwise, we've got 120 times the distance to G, it is 3, plus we've got 70 times the distance to G, it is 6, Lastly, we've got 90 times the distance to G is 8. Therefore, we can now calculate the value of F. We're going to say 90 times 2.5, it gives us 225 plus 8F, F times 8 is 8F, being equals to 120 times 3, it's going to give us 360 plus 70 times 6, it's giving us 420 plus 90 times 8, it's giving us 720. But because we are looking for F, it means that we have to transpose 225 to the other side, meaning that it's going to change its sign and becomes negative. We're going to have 8F being equals to the total sum of these values. It's 720 plus 420 plus 360. It gives us 1,500 minus the 225 that we're going to take to the right-hand side, 225. So you've got 1,500 minus 2,025 minus 225 is equals to 1,275, being equals to 8F. Then for us to find F, we divide both sides by 8. Then F is equals to 1,275 divided by 8, of which it gives us 159.375 Newton meters. Then from here we can write our value for F being equals to 159.375 Newton meters. These values, we just indicate them here so that when we draw our shear force, of which is what we're going to do next, we can easily identify the reaction F and the reaction G. So I'm going to erase the board so that we can draw the shear force diagram. Like in our previous example, I've told you that when you draw your shear force diagram, you must align it, you must align your Cartesian plane together with the beam. And everywhere where we have a force, we're going to make a dotted line so that it acts as a guideline for us when we draw our shear force. We've got a dotted line there and a dotted line there. If you are looking closely, I did not draw a dotted line on 120. This force, you remove it because this force was only assisting you in calculating the reactions F and G. It is a uniformly distributed load. So it remains as it is. And then we don't indicate the 120 value. It was only there to assist us in our calculation. From there, we do the same thing that we are doing. Remember that we are only indicating the directions of forces that are being applied on the beam. So when you look at the first point, we're going to start at zero. You've got the force 90 that is going down, and force F that is going up. Force F is our reaction. It's always going up so that it supports the beam. And we said that any force that is going down, we consider it to be negative. And any force that is going up, we consider it to be positive. So here you've got a force 90 going down and a force F going up. You're going to say minus 90 because it's going down, plus 159.375, it's going up. It's going to take us to 69 positive 69.375. Then from here, we move to the next force. We make a straight line to the next force. Our next force is 70. Where is it going? It is going downwards, meaning that it becomes negative. You're going to say positive 69.375 minus 70. Then you get not minus 0.625. That's the value that we get. But this beam compared to the other one, this one has what we call a uniformly distributed load, meaning that our shear force diagram is going to be a little bit different. We're now going to look at our UDL to say that between the forces 70 and 80, we've got a UDL for a distance of 6 meters. So if you have a UDL, you're now going to calculate how your shear force is now going to slope. We're no longer going to move down or sideways, but we're going to slope because we've got UDL. So you're now going to say 6 times 20, of which is the distance of our UDL, and this is how much of the load is being applied per meter, of which it gives us 120. And where is our UDL going? Because it's also a force. It's going down. It's a force that is applied in the downward direction, meaning that the 120 that we have, we're going to have minus 6.25 minus 120. 0.625 minus 120, meaning that we're going to get minus 120, we're going to slope down to minus 120.625. From there, we are now at force 80 and reaction G. They are on the same axis, meaning that you've got 80 that is going down, it's negative, 290.625, which is going up, it's positive. We're now going to say that we have a negative value of minus 120.625, then we're going to minus the 80 that is going down, plus the 290.625 that is going up. Then we end up having a value of 90, meaning that we're going to go up straight to 90. That is our value. From the force G to the next force, of which is 90, we no longer have a UDL, meaning that we're now going to go straight to the next force. Our next force is 90. It's going down, meaning that it becomes negative. But where are we? We are at positive 90, meaning that positive 90 minus 90, we get zero. Meaning that our beam closes, our beam is in equilibrium, the forces, they balance each other. We are now going to continue to calculate our bending moments of the very same beam. Like I said in our first example that we did, that for every force that you have when you want to calculate bending moments, you have to put alphabets that will assist you in calculating the bending moments on each force. The first force, it's A. The next force, it's B. The third one, it's C. The fourth, it's D. But many of you will ask to say, but we've got a force and a force. Yes, we do. But 90 and the reaction force F, they are on the same set of axes, meaning that they can share a letter. So is 80 and reaction G. So from there, you're now going to say that bending moments at A What is bending moments at A? We have explained in our example to say that bending moments at A is equals to zero. But why? The reason, the first reason is that our beam starts at A. That is why it's zero. It's because we don't have a distance before A and we don't have a force before A. So that is how our bending moments at A become zero. Then we've got bending moments at B. When you look at bending moments at B, you must check, what forces do I have that come before B? You've got 90, and then you've got 159.375. Remember what we said. Any force that is going down is negative, and any force that is going up, it is positive. So we're now going to say, for bending moments at B, we've got minus 90 times the distance to B, it's 2, plus you've got 159.375 times the distance to B, it's 2 meters, equals 2. Then we can get a value at B. But there's another way of doing the bending moments at B, because you've got two forces on the same axis. It means that you can start by saying minus 90 plus 159.375. They give you 69.375. Then that is the total force that is acting on this point A. Then times the distance to B, it's 2. You will get the same value as what we are doing here. But I prefer that we do this method because it is clearer for you to follow and to understand that we've got a negative force going down and a positive force going up. So let's calculate the value here. You're going to say open brackets minus 90 times 2, then you close the brackets and say plus open brackets 159.375 times 2, close brackets, then equals 2. Then we get positive 138.75 Newton meters. From there, we can now calculate bending moments at C. So we are now doing bending moments at C, but you must see how it's going to change. We're now going to check how many forces do we have before C. We've got F, we've got 90, we've got 70. It's three forces, meaning that we've got minus 90 times the distance to C. It is 8 meters. Plus you've got positive 159.375 times the distance to C, it's 8. Plus you've got minus 70 times the distance to C, it's 6. Plus, remember it's minus 70 because it's going down. But between 70 and 80, or between B and C, we've got a UDL for a distance of 6 meters, meaning that we're going to make our UDL a point load. We're going to say 6 meters times 20 Newton per meter. Meter cancels meter, and then we'll be left with 120. But it becomes negative because I said earlier that our UDL is going downwards, or is applying force in the downward direction. But then, because we've got 120, then we say this point load, it acts at the center of our UDL, meaning that the distance that we now have is 3 meters for this particular point load of 120. Meaning that when we are calculating bending moments at C, You're now going to say we've got a force of minus 120 times the distance to C, of which is 3. Then we can calculate our value there. You start by saying open brackets, minus 90 times 8, close brackets, plus open brackets, 159,375 times 8, close brackets, plus open brackets, minus 70 times 6, close brackets, plus open brackets, minus 120 times 3, close brackets. Then equal sign, we get minus 225 Newton meters. Now bending moments at D becomes zero because that's where our beam ends. But now sometimes you might have a question to say that prove that bending moments at D is zero. So it means that you're going to start with the same process in identifying how many forces do you have before D. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 forces. But remember that our UDL, we have converted it converted the UDL to become a point load. So it becomes our sixth force. So from there you then say minus 90 times the distance to D, it's 10,5 plus 159,375 times the distance to D is 10.5 plus minus 70 times the distance to D, it's 8.5 plus minus 120 of our UDL. The distance is going to become 5,5 plus we've got minus 80 times the distance to UDL, it's 2,5 plus we've got positive 290,625 times the distance 2,5. Then we calculate to get the value of D. But the expected value is that we will get a zero value. Then you're going to say open brackets minus 90 times 10.5 close bracket plus open bracket 159,375 times 10.5 close bracket plus open bracket minus 70 times 8.5 close brackets plus open brackets minus 120 times 5.5 close brackets plus minus 80 times 2,5 close brackets plus positive open brackets positive 290,625 times 2,5 close brackets equals 2. Then our value is exactly 0, meaning that we have started from 0 and then we end from 0. We are now going to stop right here for the lesson of today. On our next lesson, we will then continue in drawing the bending moment graph so that we can indicate to ourselves what is the maximum bending moment of this beam and what is the minimum bending moment of this beam. But we can recap quickly to remind you that remember that bending moments at A is zero because that's where our beam starts, and then bending moments at D is also always zero because that's where our beam ends. So from here on our next session, we will then proceed to draw our bending moment graph. I thank you.